Give me a minute, please.
తొందరగా డౌన్లోడ్ చేయి, చేసి అందులో అప్లోడ్ చేసి
Yes, now all set. We can start today's session. So good morning all. Once again, I welcome you all for this training program on cybersecurity. And yesterday we covered the basics of Windows and Linux, and then we got to know how you can actually install Linux on VirtualBox using something called virtualization and all. But today we'll be talking about networking. Right, the core of your ethical hacking is what nothing is the networking. If you know the networking, then actually that cybersecurity topic will be easily actually you can understand it. So today we'll talk about TCP/IP. And before again starting of the session, I'll asking you some questions. Right. So the question number one to you all, because you people are using internet, everybody is now connected to internet. We should know, what do you mean by internet? What is an internet? Can you please write on the chat window, small, very small definition, what you know about internet? What is an internet? Okay. So the same question I asked to my daughter. She is actually studying in fifth standard, and she is 11 years old. I asked her, what do you understand by internet? So as per her, she is only 11 years old and going in fifth standard. She is telling, the internet actually is this, right? The internet actually is this, as per my daughter. She is 11 years old. She is telling, people are sitting, they are having mobile phone with them, and then they are actually accessing, doing something. They are accessing internet, right? Then I shown some more picture to her. You tell me, what is the internet? Then again she told me, this is what is an internet, where a lot of people are sitting on the computer system and they are working on it, right? And they are connected to the internet. Then I told, actually this is the usage of internet. People are using internet, but this is not is what you call as the internet. This is the people which are actually using the services, what is called an is an internet. So I shown this picture to her. I told her that this is what you actually called as an internet, where you have I request a narrator to mute his and Naresh, can you please switch off your microphone? You please mute yourself. I guess echo they are hearing. So this picture I shown her, and I told, this is what is you called as an internet, where you are having a lot of systems are connected across the globe, and everybody is actually connected to that particular network, which is what is called as an internet. So if you define internet, this is actually what is the actual internet, which is connected to across the globe. So if this picture you elaborate more, then this is what is the internet. You can see here, you have fiber cables which is connected throughout the globe, everywhere. So suppose you are sitting here in India, this is the India, right? You are sitting here in Bangalore, this is the Bangalore, and you are accessing a website which is actually there in USA, suppose here, right? So this is the connectivity which has been happened here. So you are going with a lot of hops and routers in between, and then you are actually reaching to the destination, to this particular website which is running in United States of America, USA, right? So this is what is the actual internet, and where everybody is connected, all the networks are connected, and these fiber cables are actually going, some of the cables are going through sea, under the sea, right? So if you define internet, what you understand by internet is this. You can say that internet is network, right? It's a network, you can say, but it is not only network. If you take an example here, if I am sitting in this lab, If you can see, I have so many systems there in my background. So in this lab, we have say 10 systems, right? And 9 systems are not connected anywhere. They are connected to single LAN, which is not part of any internet, right? So you cannot say internet is only network. Then what is internet? Internet is network of networks. So you can say that internet is what? It's a network of networks. So you have a multiple networks which is again connected. But this is also not true in some cases. For example, suppose this is one network in C-DAC Electronicity. We have this network. We have one more network actually which is in C-DAC Hyderabad, right? Then we have in C-DAC Trivandrum. All are interconnected, but those networks are not exposed to in public or internet, right? So you cannot say that it's a network of networks. So we are using a network, even C-DAC Hyderabad, right? C-DAC Kolkata, Mohali, everybody is connected to one network, but that is actually not exposed to the internet. Then you cannot say that internet is network of network. It's not true. Then what is it? So you can say that finally, internet is network, but that network should be accessible by anybody in the world. So it's a network of network which is globally accessible by the end users. Anybody in the world, he or she should be able to connect to the network, then that is network is called is an internet. So as I told you, this is what is an internet, right? So everybody is connected. It's a global network. It's a global network. It is a global network. If I'm sitting here, I can access any of the website which is running across the globe, right? Or I want to send an email, I can send anywhere in the globe, right? So this is what you call an internet. So now we understood what is the meaning of internet. Now let us, yesterday I gave you some of the pictures. Today also let us see what picture I'm having for you. Can you guess these people? Can you guess who are those people? Can you guess? If you know them, you can type on the chat window. If you know them, then please type on the chat window. Very good. Amit Batra is telling Windsurf. Both are Windsurf. Okay, one of them is Windsurf. He is a left-hand person. Very good. Then right-hand one is Bob Kahn. Windsurf and Bob Kahn. So these two people are there who are actually father of the internet. You can say these two are father of the internet. They only have developed, you can say, internet. So they developed a protocol which is called TCP/IP. So today's session is on TCP/IP. These two people have actually developed that protocol which is called TCP/IP, right? So these are the father of the internet, Windsurf and Bob Kahn. Now, if you are using internet, you should know how actually you are connected, how the communication is happening between endpoints. So if you are sending an email sitting from one system, how it is going to the other system, or how actually the end the abstraction level of communication is happening between two machines, that you should know. So for that, we have a protocol, right? We have one standard. Here you can say it's a standard ISO OSI model. It is a standard for internet communication or network communication. It's a standard. So ISO is what? It is called the International Standard Organization. ISO is International Standard Organization, where the OSI is nothing, Open System Interconnection Reference Model. So it's only a reference model. It is not actual implementation, right? This is the model which says that this is how the communication will happen between the end users or end systems or end devices, right? So this model follows something called layers. So this model, which is called ISO OSI model, it follows layers, layer 1, layer 2, layer 3, and so on. So you can see here we have 7 layers, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Total 7 layers are there in this ISO OSI model. On top of that, we have application layer, right? Then we have presentation layer. Then we have session, transport, network, data link, and finally what we have is a physical layer. So we'll just understand the abstract of this, all the layers, what is the use of those layers. We'll just see. Now you can see here, each layer is having a data. So you have application layer. In the application layer, you have a data, right? And application layer will attach some additional things. So this is your data, which has to be sent from source to destination. For example, this data has to be sent from source to destination. Now it will be passed on to application layer. Now what application layer will do, it will add something called a header, right? So this is the header and the data. Now again, this application layer, whatever this header and data it has made, it will pass on the same to the next layer, is called presentation layer, right? And this full thing will be become a data for presentation layer, right? Now presentation layers, this is the data for the presentation layer. Presentation layer will add the header, right? It's called application header, presentation header, and the same will be passed to session layer. Again, session layer, for the session layer, this particular full will become a data for session layer, and session layer will add some header. So each layer is adding something called header. So we'll see what is header, what is the information of inside the header and all, right? Then you have transport layer, and the transport layer, again, this particular full thing, which is coming from the session layer, which is given to the transport layer, this part is full data for it, and it will add something called transport header. Same thing, network header, data link header. So data link along with this header, it will add something called trailer, right? Header and trailer. So only data link layer will only append trailer in that full among the seven layers. So only data link layer will add this trailer, right? Whereas all other layers are adding only header. Okay, so this is what is OSI model, right? So every layer will add header, right? And finally, that layer, which is called physical layer, this full data will be transmitted in the network in the form of zeros and ones, right? Whether signal is on or signal is off. Okay. So you can see here, the same thing what we have seen, you can see here how the communication is happening from source to the destination. So this is the source, right? This is the destination. Now, what is happening? Source want to send a packet to the destination, but destination is there in somewhere else. It is not part of the same network. For example, we'll say what is network and all, we'll see later, right? Now, what is happening here? This full data packet, which has been created here, you can see this is nothing. It's a packet which has been created here. This packet or frame actually is being routed from one system to other system. So in between one system is there. This is one system. This is the client. This is the server. In between one system is there. It is called a router, right? Which will route the packet to the correct destination. So that system will check up to the network layer. It will open that packet which has been coming from here up to the network layer, and we'll see what is the content, where to forward this packet, what is the destination of that packet, where I need to forward it, right? So it will open up to here, and then same, if it will see that I need to forward the same packet to this next destination, then it will forward, right? So host, or we can say source, will send the packet, it will come to intermediate router, and it will forward to the destination. So it will happen. So there may be multiple intermediate routers. So from this router, one more router may come here, then one more may come here, and finally it will reach to this destination, right? So this is the communication between the end host, how it is happening. Now you can see here we have a lot of layers. Why we need this layering approach? Why this layers has come into the picture? Why can't only one single protocol and then that should communicate? Why you have created multiple layers inside this OSI model? So for that, this is what is the solution, what they're telling, why layering is required. If there is no layering, if I'm not using layering, then what will happen here? Each new application has to be re-implemented for every network technology. For example, we have different transmission media. You have coaxial cable, right? You have a different coaxial cable, twisted pair, you might have seen, right? And then you have fiber optics, fiber optical cables. Then you have radio packets, right? Wi-Fi packets and all. For each and other transmission medium, you have to develop the protocol, right? For coaxial cable, telnet, this is the protocol. Or you can say HTTP is what is nothing. It is a web server protocol or web browsing protocol, right? So this HTTP has to develop for each and every transmission medium. So it's a difficult task, right? This has to be developed for coaxial cable, again for fiber optics, for packet radio, Wi-Fi, whatever. So like this, we have to do. Now, if layering is there, then what is happening? Intermediate layers provides a unique abstraction for various network technologies. So if layer approach is there, so you only developed a telnet for one time, and then that can be used for coaxial cable, for fiber optics, for packet radio. So in between, you have abstraction here. So this layering will do the task of sending packets from source to the destination, right? So this is why the layering is required. Some more advantages, right? So you can see here, divide a task into the pieces, then solve each pieces independently, right? So if you have a very big task, then what you can do, you divide the task into the subtask, and then you can reassemble those pieces, right? So this is why what we are using layering. Again, establishing a well-defined interface between layer, making porting easier, right? So what you are telling, establishing a well-defined interface. So we have a lot of interfaces between layers, and porting from one layer to each other layer, it is actually making it easier. Function of each layer are independent of function of other layers. So you can see here, function of each layer, what we have seen, is independent of other layers. So this will do some function, this will again do some function, this will do some function, and so on, right? So function is divided. One function divided here and here. So we'll see what is the functions of this layer. Okay, so again, thus each layer is like a module and can be developed independently. So you have different functions, so develop those functions independently. So this is the advantages, major advantages and advantages for this layering approach is what? You can reuse the code, right? For example, here, suppose you want to do some changes in transport, no need to change in application or server. You only do changes here, and then it will work. So this is one of the advantages, eases maintenance and updating. The same thing what I told is mentioned here. Okay. So let us see each and every layer, application layer. In OSI, we have 7 layers, right? So these are the 7 layers, right? So application layer will do what? So application layer 1, sir. Yes. Application layer will do what? So at this layer, one application must format the data so that second application can properly interpret it. What does that mean? So you have one application running into the one system, which is called source. Okay, let me open Paint, MS Paint. Then, okay. So it is telling that you have one application here. So I'll say that I have, this is one source and this is one destination, right? This is one source and the destination. Now application layer will do what? It will format the data. So you have source, right? And then you have a destination. So application layer will format the data. So you are using at the source is, you say that I want to access a web server which is running on the destination. So here a web server is running, right? So web server will always use a port which is called 80 port. Suppose it is not secured. If it is secured, then it will use 443. Suppose currently we are using 80 port, right? So what is happening? The source will try to connect to this web server, right? So it has to format the data here so that it will connect to this web server. So data formatting will be done at the application layer so that the web server can be accessed from this source, right? So this is one application. You can say this is one more application. So same thing is written at this layer. One application must format the data. The data formatting has to be done at the application so that the second application, this other application, can properly interpret it, right? So if web server is running, the data has to be forwarded for the web server to access. That's all. So this is the task of application layer. Next is what? Presentation layer. Presentation layer is nothing. It will actually do the data compression or encryption. If you want to encrypt the data, if you want to compress the data, you have to say that I have to use a presentation layer. How to present your data, right? At the source, I'll present the data in encryption. So suppose here, we are running 443, right? If it's 443 means it's a secure web server is running, HTTPS is running, so encryption is happening. So presentation layer will encrypt and it will send data here. It will send to the next layers and all, and the data will be reached here, right? So presentation layer will present the data in some format, right? And whether you want to encrypt or you want to say compress or do whatever, you can do using presentation layer. Next is session layer. So this layer starts and maintain and stop the logical connection between two applications, right? So session layer will do what? It will create or maintain the sessions. So here in the source, there are multiple tabs you opened, right? Accessing the same websites, right? So multiple tab means multiple session it has to create to access those websites, right? So you open multiple tabs. One tab you open, there you written the same web server. Again, second tab also you open the same web server. Third tab also you open the same web server on the browser I'm talking about here, right? So in the browser, multiple tab which you opened here, those tabs should maintain the session, right? So that web server will say that, okay, this, whatever I'm giving the reply, which is for that tab or for the other tab or whatever. So session layer will maintain the session. So it has to maintain the session, right? Then comes transport layer. Then comes transport layer. So transport layer will do what? So when a block of data is sent from one application to another, a mechanism are needed to provide the error checking. So if I am sending one data from here to here, first what I'll do, I will divide the data. So if I have some request, I will divide that request into multiple things, and then I have to receive here, right? If I receive here, I'll check whether the data has come here in the correct format or not. In between, see, it will go in zeros and ones. Sometimes if signal misbehave, that time the error will come, right? So what will happen here, you will get the correct data. So it will check whether the data which has received to destination is correct or not, right? Okay, so again, parsing the large block data into some smaller packets. So here what we are doing in the transport layer, the big data is divided into small tasks or small part, and the same part will be sent to the destination. So again, at the destination, it has to reassemble all the parts. So if I have divided the data into five parts, the five parts should be assembled and should be given to the actual web server, right? So that is what is the work of transport layer. Okay. Again, it also does a flow control. Transport layer also does a flow control. So if your destination is fast, source is slow. Source is supposed very slow and destination is faster. So, or you can see destination is slow, source is faster. So transport layer will do the flow control. It will make destination or source in the same speed of destination, right? It's the same speed of destination. So whoever is slow, in that particular speed only, the data will be transferred from source to destination. So it will do the flow control, flowing, right? So these are the tasks of transport layer. So we have come up to transport layer. If you see here, application, presentation, session, transfer, four layers we have covered. Now next three layers, let us try to discuss. Any doubt here till now? Any doubt? Anything? Port and all, I'll explain the port, because that is when we'll discuss about TCP and all, that time port will come. This is only at the abstract layer what we are seeing. I'll discuss ports and all. Yeah. So next is what? Network layer. Now, network layer is what? What it will do? So you have this source, you have destination in between, lot of hops are there, right? So if I am sitting here in Bangalore and destination is in, say, Delhi, in between lot of hops are there, lot of, say, routers are there. So how the packet or how the data will be transferred from source to destination, who will take care? Network layer will take care, right? how the data will be transferred from source to the destination, network layer only will take care of that, right? So once a packet from the transport layer is placed on the network, it needs to find the way from physical host to another host. So one physical host to another host, how it will be sent, network layer only will do, right? So this is the responsibility of network layer. It provides the routing. So routing means what? To reach from this source to destination, what route I will take, it will check, right? It will only decide. Network layer only will decide. If source is there, destination in between, say I have a 10 routers, right? So how I'll go to, or how the packet will go to one router to another router up to the destination, network layer only will decide, right? So this is the functionality of network layer. Then comes the data link layer. Now, what is the work of data link layer? Is nothing. Data link layer handles the bit level specifications used to deliver the message within the specific type of network. For example, I will say here that I have one network here. I'll say this is the switch, right? It is a network switch. I'll type here, this is the network switch. So you know what is network switch? So your system will be connected to the network switch, and even other systems are connected. So communication will happen, right? Through network switch. So this system is connected to this network switch, right? This is connected here. And we have some more systems are connected, right? Some more systems are connected. Apart from that, we have our router also is connected, right? Our router. So this is nothing, it's a router. Then what is there? Then you have one more network switch at the destination side, right? And then that is being connected to the destination. Now, what is happening here? Inside the LAN, so this is nothing, it's a LAN. This is what it is. It is called local area network, LAN. So you, if you have a network switch where all your systems are connected, then you are forming something called local area network, LAN, right? So to forward a packet or a frame from one system to another system in the LAN, you are using something called MAC address, MAC, MAC, media access control. This is part of data link layer. This is part of data link layer. So to send a packet from one source to destination inside the LAN, first it will be forwarded. So packet will come up to here, right? Using MAC, your packet will be reaching to your router. Now router will forward to this MAC, right? This MAC will forward to the other MAC. And from here, directly it will go to here, right? From here, it will go to directly here. So this is the functionality of data link layer, right? So here, while the network layer uses logical addresses to identify the host, data link layer uses the physical address, which is called MAC address of the hardware. So here we are using the MAC address, right? Here we are using the MAC address for sending a data from one system to other system inside the LAN, not in the WAN or wide area network. Inside the local area network, the packet is coming because it has to reach here, right? So how it will reach here, it will use MAC address to send from here to here one packet. Okay? Again, from here to here, it will use a MAC address, right? Then MAC address, and it will reach to destination. Okay, and then physical layer, you know what is that? I told you. So your data, which is coming in packets, it has to be transmitted in zeros and ones, and then in the media, it will say that zeros and voltage level, it will use to transmit that, and it will be sending to the destination, right? So these are the OSI layer. This is what the same thing what we discussed is mentioned here. Application layer does what? It allow access to network resources. So you have data, you will format in some format which is accepted by the destination application, right? Presentation, again, you can encrypt, you can compress data in the presentation layer. Session layer, you have to maintain the session. You have to manage, create the sessions. Session layer will do that. Again, transport layer, process to process message delivery it will do, right? And it will do error recovery. Now, what is the process to process? You have one process which is running, it is called a Firefox. Here you have a process which is running, which is called a web server. So this process to that process some message which has to be delivered. It will be task of transport layer, right? So it will use the port number there. We'll discuss what is the port number, right? Then you have network layer. Network layer will move the packet from source to destination, right? And it will provide the internetworking. So source destination from here to here at the network layer, packet will transfer, but actually it will use the MAC address inside to transfer the packet, which is it in data link layer, hop to hop delivery, right? Hop to hop delivery. Process to process is not clear. I'll tell you when we'll come to that TCP IP protocol, that time this is only standard. What we are discussing is only standard. Well, we'll come to TCP IP protocol, right? There we'll just see what is process to process and port number will be there. Okay, so this part is clear. Now let us discuss, what do you understand by a protocol? What do you mean by a protocol, right? A protocol is a collection of rules and procedure for computer to exchange the information. For example, I am using a protocol which is called English language, right? So in the English language protocol, I'm just speaking English, you are understanding it, right? So there we have alphabet, so we have standard there. We have alphabet, letters, words, or whatever. So it's a protocol. So for the communication between you and me, I'm using something called English language, right? So in that, we have a standard there. The same thing, protocol is collection of rules. So I have a rules. What is the rules? Rules is that this is the word, this is the meaning of word and all. So these are the rules. Same thing is in networking also. So protocol is collections of rules, right? And procedure, which will be used for two computers to exchange the information or for the communication. So protocol also defines the format of data that is being exchanged. So what kind of data which we are exchanging from my system to your system, protocol will decide that, okay. Now let us discuss, what is TCP/IP? As I told you, OSI model, we have 7 layers, right? And that is only standard, it is not implementation. But the actual implementation where the internet is using is what? TCP/IP. Internet is not using OSI, right? Internet is actually using what is TCP/IP. So TCP/IP is nothing, it's a set of protocols developed to allow the cooperating computers to share resources across the network. So that's what, for the network communication, always we'll be using something called TCP/IP. And who has developed this TCP/IP? Bob Kahn and Winston. So TCP stand for Transmission Control Protocol, IP stand for Internet Protocol. So this is two major component of this TCP/IP, Internet Protocol. We'll just see this later. So they are transport layer and network layer protocol. So this TCP is transport layer protocol, IP is network layer protocol, we'll see here. So as I told you, the most well-known network that adopted TCP/IP is our internet. So our internet is only using this TCP/IP. Our internet is actually using this TCP/IP, which is the biggest WAN in the world. WAN is nothing, it's called wide area network. So internet is nothing, it's a WAN, wide area network in the world. And this WAN is globally accessible by anybody in the world, right? So why it is so popular? Because everybody is using. So full internet is using, WAN is using, right? So this is so popular. Again, you can see it is supported by most of the operating system, Unix operating system, Windows, Linux, Android, anybody if you see, it is supported. All the operating system is being supported by this TCP/IP, right? So this is very popular. So in ISO OSI model, we had 7 layers, right? But here we will have only 4 layers, layer 1, layer 2, layer 3, layer 4. So here you can see we have the application layer, right? There also we had application layer, application presentation session. These 3 layers are combined in this application layer now, right? This application layer only will do the formatting, it will do session maintenance, right? So application layer. Then what we have is a transport layer. This is TCP/IP network model, which is actually been used by our network communication in the internet. Next is transport layer, right? Then it is called network layer. Then finally it is called link layer. So link layer is the data link layer and physical layer, both the layer are now combined here. So all the 7 layers are combined into this 4 layers in TCP/IP, right? So let us discuss here now. OSI and TCP/IP protocol stack. You see here, these seven layers which I was talking here in OSI model, it is now here in only four layer. So as I told you, application layer, presentation layer, session layer in OSI model, now all these three, functionality of three is combined into single layer, which is called application layer, right? And these are the protocols which is in application layer, right? So application layer means application which you are running. For example, I am running an application which is called FTP. So FTP is application. So FTP will come under application. I am running a protocol called SMTP for sending an email. So this is again one application, right? Sending an email, receiving an email is nothing. It's an application. So SMTP also will fall under the category of application layer because it is an application. Now HTTP, it's a web browsing, right? Web server. So it's an application. Right, which will allow you to browse a website. So this is again is an application layer protocol which will fall under the category of application layer. So any application, if you talk, right, that will always will be a part of application layer, right? So we have a lot of application, telnet, we have SSH, right, we have DNS, all are nothing, it is called an application. So any application which is there in the internet, it will fall under something called application layer in TCP/IP, right? Then you have transport layer here, right? In transport layer, we have a two major protocol, TCP and UDP. TCP and UDP. So these two protocols are there in the transport layer. These two major protocols are there. Then we have a network layer. In the network layer, we have two protocol here. You can see IP and ICMP, right? IP means Internet Protocol and ICMP, right? This is used for network troubleshooting, ICMP. And at the data link layer, here it is called a link layer. We have a lot of protocols. Majorly used protocol is what? Ethernet. So currently I am using my system, and in that we have a network adapter, and that actually is using nothing. They are using this Ethernet protocol. And this Ethernet protocol, we have actually two sub protocol, you can say, ARP, address resolution protocol, and RARP, reverse address resolution protocol. We'll discuss about all the protocol in the next few slides, right? All this protocol, which is part of each and every other layers, we'll discuss. And finally, we'll discuss how the packet will be traversing from source to destination using these layers. So what will be the content of those different application, right? Different layers. What are the actually content of those different layers, right? So this will you see. Now, application layer protocol. Any question you have? Yeah, we have some slides on TCP and UDP. We'll discuss here. TCP and UDP, we'll discuss later. We have slides. So that time we'll discuss. Up to here, if you have any doubt in that, you can ask. The layers, what I'm talking about, right? So in OSI, it's only standard, right? OSI is standard. OSI is standard. Whereas the implementation here is TCP/IP. OSI is nothing. It is having seven layers in the standard. But in TCP/IP, we have only four layers, right? So these are the four layers which is mentioned here. Ethernet is again a protocol which is in link layer. Or data link layer. Ethernet is nothing, it's a protocol in the link layer which will send a packet or a frame from one host to other host at the data link layer. Amit Batra is telling refer slide number 7. Now I have to go back to slide number 7. It's very, 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 very. What is your question? Can you please repeat your question? Here, what is your question? Amit, you please tell your question. The slide will be given to you. Don't worry, today I'll give you the slides. Okay. Amit is telling, where will be the addition of header take place? How to imagine it? Once we will see the header part, that time we'll get to know. So you have a lot of headers. You can see this is Ethernet headers, right? That time I'll discuss how you can imagine that. Ethernet headers, IP headers, everything I'll show you, right? So we'll just discuss that. Don't worry. This is only we just covered the abstract part. We'll go into the deep now. If we will get the time, I guess, I hope we have time, right? Up to say 10:45 I can take. Still I have 15 minutes. And after that, actually at say 2:15, I have one more session. The continuation of this I'll do there, right? Suppose I'm not able to complete this year, I will continue there. And then continue 3-4 sessions I have after that. So that time we'll do everything. Chaitanya is telling any other suite of protocol there other than the TCP/IP in WAN. See, in internet, they are only using TCP/IP, but for experimental, lot of protocols are there. But on the internet, they are only using TCP/IP, right? Okay, so let us discuss the application layer protocols. So this protocols we'll try to discuss application layer protocols. So application protocols, we have a lot of application layer protocols. Only few we are discussing. We have FTP, file transfer protocol. If you want to transfer a file from one destination, one source to another destination, then you can use FTP. You might have already used FTP, right? So one file is there, which is sitting on my system. You want to download that file, right? So I will run something called FTP server on my system, and you'll be running an FTP client, and you can download, right? So this FTP we'll be discussing later also. Telnet. Telnet is again one application layer protocol, which will allow you for doing what? It's again one application, which will allow you to access any system remotely. For example, I want to access your system remotely, right? So you already logged in on the system, you're sitting somewhere in say Delhi or somewhere in Mumbai. I want to access your system remotely. So in your system, you should provide me the access. So you should run something called Telnet server in your system, and I'll be running something called Telnet client. Using Telnet client, I can remotely access your system, I can access your files, I can access whatever you're doing, right? So that is called a Telnet. It's a remote access protocol. Then you have SMTP, again, as application layer protocol. SMTP is simple mail transfer protocol. So you want to send an email from one system to other system, you use SMTP. For example, Gmail, right? Gmail, Yahoo Mail, all they are using something called SMTP only, simple mail transfer protocol, right? So it's again an application. It is an application. So it is a application layer protocol. Then you have HTTP, hypertext transfer protocol, for web browsing or web surfing. So you suppose a web server is running. See, all these protocol which I'm talking about, they're following something called client and server system, right? So you have a client, you have a server. So HTTP, you should have a server somewhere. For example, www.google.com. We are running an HTTP server somewhere in the USA, right? And the client I am running here on the browser. So browser will become HTTP client for web browsing, whereas the server is there somewhere in the world, right? So these all are called application layer protocols. And using in the afternoon, using Wireshark, we'll try to see what kind of packets we can see in the network. So I'll show you what I mean by Wireshark, what is network packet and all, how to view that network packet, right? And how to view the network packet of FTP, how to view network packet of Telnet, SMTP, and so on. So we talked about application layer protocol. This layer, these protocols we have talked about. Now we're talking about the transport layer protocol. So we have mainly two protocol at the transport layer, right? We have a TCP and UDP, right? So TCP and UDP is nothing. TCP says that I am a connection-oriented protocol. So TCP always maintains the connection from one source to destination. So here, what is happening? If you see this, I am having one data which has to be sent to this destination. So TCP ensure that this data from here to destination will traverse without any error. The TCP protocol will ensure that the data from this source to this decision will traverse in the network to network without any error. So this is what is the TCP. It's a connection oriented. It will maintain the connection. So it will, if I want to send a file from here to there, I'll say that I want to send you. You will reply, you can send, then I will send like that. And once I have sent, it will say, I acknowledge your data. So it is maintaining the connection. So if suppose if I am communicating, I'll say, am I audible? You'll say that, yes, you're audible. Then I'll again say something, then you say, yeah, we got to know. So this is what is a part of TCP. It is maintaining the connection. It's the connection oriented, right? So whatever I'm sending, you are acknowledging, yes, I have received, right? Whatever I'm telling, you are listening and you are acknowledging that, sir, we are able to hear you, you are audible, right? So same thing here in TCP. Same thing here is TCP. So TCP will say that, I am sending you data, have you received or not? The destination will say that, yes, I have received your data and it is in correct form, no error is there. If error is there, I'll again resend, right? So this is the functionality of TCP, Transmission Control Protocol. It says that the data which you're sending, it is being received properly. Then we have one more protocol in the TCP IP transport layer, if you can see this transport layer, TCP we have talked about, right? Now we have one more protocol called UDP. Now UDP, if you see here, UDP is connectionless. What do you mean by connectionless? If I am sending you some data, I will not get an acknowledgement. So I'm just keep reading my slides. I'm keep discussing. I don't know whether you are able to hear or not, right? You are not acknowledging. So this is what is UDP, right? It is connectionless. It is not maintaining the connection. Whatever you are sending, you don't know whether it is receiving, whatever I'm sending, I don't know whether you are receiving or not, right? And you will not give any acknowledgement. So that is called user datagram service or user datagram protocol. Right, so this is the biggest difference between TCP and UDP. So where will you use TCP, where will you use UDP? So in some situation where you want to guarantee that my files should be transferred there you have to use that TCP at the transport layer. For example, HTTP. In HTTP, you want to browse internet or you want to browse a website called google.com. So HTTP will use TCP under transport layer protocol. Right, because it has to guarantee that you are browsing. It has to guarantee that you are browsing. So whatever Google is responding that web browser, the data, you should be able to see that. Even FTP, the file transfer, right? So file transfer protocol also will use TCP inside transport layer. Why? Because it should guarantee that whatever I'm sending, you should be able to receive and it should be correct format, right? But if you see here, this TCP will be slow as compared to UDP. Why it is slow? TCP will be slow. Why? Because if I am sending, then you are acknowledging. So one extra step you are adding. If I am sending, you are acknowledging. I am sending, acknowledging, sending, acknowledging. So it is a process will be slow, right? If I am speaking, then you say, yes, sir, I heard about only TCP, I heard about UDP, you are replying and all. Then this process will become slow, right? Whereas in UDP, whatever I'm just sending or whatever I'm communicating, you're just listening, right? You're not acknowledging. So UDP will be always fast as compared to TCP, right? Because UDP is not giving the acknowledgement. It is just keeps simply sending. So who will use UDP now? UDP, who will use? FTP will not use, Telnet will not use, SMT will not use, HTTP will not use. We have another application layer protocol. We have something called a DNS, right? For IP2 domain name lookup, we have a protocol called DNS. Or you can see we have something called web broadcasting of videos. Broadcasting of videos, right? Suppose you are watching a match live on Hotstar. That Hotstar, they will use UDP. Why? Because if it will reply back and all, Hotstar the video will say delayed video will get. I don't want delayed video. Whatever match which is happening, I should be able to see live, right? So in the live, in between, suppose some packet is wrong, you will see some haziness, that's all. But still you'll be able to see the video, right? So your video streaming and all, they will use UDP. Where you want to see the live video and all, you always will use UDP, right? So I guess you are clear with TCP and UDP. Any doubt here? Any question? Okay, let us move on now. Now let us discuss network layer protocols, right? So we discussed about application layer protocols, this 3-4 whatever were there, we discussed. Then we discussed, see, application layer, we have a lot of protocols. We have not discussed all, only few are discussed, right? Transport layer, these two major protocols are there, which is in use, both of them we discussed. Now at the network layer, let us try to discuss this protocol, which is called IP, right? At network layer, we'll discuss. Chaitanya is telling what protocols are used at session layer. See, I am talking about TCP IP. I'm not talking about OSI. OSI only standard. Implementation is what? TCP IP. Here we don't have session layer, first of all. Do we have session layer here? No. Application layer only manages that, right? So here we don't have any protocol which is used in session layer. You understood, Chaitanya? She's asking what protocol are used in session layer. So session layer is not there in TCP IP at all. So we don't have any protocol inside the session layer, right? Because session layer is maintained by the application layer only. So these people are maintaining the sessions. HTTP is there only maintaining that. It is coded in such a way saying that they will only maintain the session, right? Okay, so now let us discuss about network layer protocol, which is only one, which is called IP, right? Internet protocol. We have some more ARP and INCMP that also we discuss. So network layer, from source to destination, you want to go or reach to the, from source you want to reach destination, always you will use something called network layer, right? So you have in between lot of hops, you have a lot of routers. So from one router to another router up to destination, how we will reach from source destination, who will tell? Network layer will tell, right? So there we have protocol called internet protocol, then we have ARP protocol, then we have ICMP protocol, right? So this IP protocol is the thing. It will provide you the packet delay from source to destination. So IP protocol will use something called IP address, right? IP address. So in IP protocol, we have two protocols used. One is IPv4, other is IPv6, right? So under this IP protocol, you can say here we are using two protocol. One is IPv4, other is IPv6, right? Then we'll see what is ARP, address resolution protocol. Then we'll see what is ICMP. It is there in few next slides. See what I'm telling here, if this particular session is up to 10:45, and then I have three more sessions, continuous session after post lunch. So whatever I am covering, this will be continued later also, right? So that it will be a sequence. Okay, so let us discuss about the data link layer protocol. So we have discussed up to here, network layer, IP, right? We'll go next also, we'll see what is IPv4, IPv6, how you can, what is addressing and all, we'll discuss here, right? Now I'll discuss the data link layer protocol, last one, right? There we'll discuss. So this is the data link layer protocol, where you have something called MAC. So you know that every system has an NIC card. Suppose that NIC card will have always a unique MAC address. It is called Media Access Control Address, right? It is a 48-bit hexadecimal number. It's a 48-bit hexadecimal number, right? So here, Ethernet protocol will always use this MAC. And this is actually the frame of the Ethernet, you can see here. So two systems are there, one system and one more system. So these two systems, if they're communicating on the Ethernet layer or data link layer, then they will follow this particular method, right? If they are communicating over Ethernet, then they'll always follow this method. So this method says that this is nothing, it's Ethernet frame. It is an Ethernet frame. It says that always it will start with a preamble of 7 bytes. Now, what do you mean by a preamble? Preamble will be always used to synchronize two entities or two source and destination. If you want to synchronize their clocks, you want to synchronize. Clocks means not physical clock, the communication clock. If you want to synchronize, then use preamble. Suppose I want to synchronize you. So I'll say that, am I audible? You'll say, you are audible. So two packets we have sent, right? So same thing. Here also, synchronizing. So people, 7 byte synchronization will happen first, right? So it will send random 7 byte. It is not random. The always byte will be always like this. It will be always like this. One, I type here in physical layer, it will be zeros and ones, right? Voltage high, voltage low. So it will be always like this. Is 8 bit, right? 4 4 8 bit. So 1 byte, again one more byte, again one more byte, right? Like that, it will send 7. Here we missed one more 1 0. Here also we missed one more 1 0. 1 0 1 0 1 0 0. So this is the preamble which will be there always. So this is what is the preamble. This sequence will be sent from source to decision always, right? So that they will synchronize. They will synchronize. Sync will happen. After that, once this is sent, one more packet will be sent. It is called one more frame will be sent, or this 8 byte will be sent, and this 8 byte will be like this, and this will always will be called as SFD. It is always will be called as SFD, right? So once this is done, once this is done, then it will come the destination MAC address, the source MAC address, right? So if I am sending a packet, my MAC address will come. Sorry, if I am sending a packet to one more system in next to me, right? So in the destination MAC address, the next MAC address of the next system will come. Source MAC address, my MAC address will come there, right? Okay. So we will do one thing now. I guess I need to stop. It is already 10:45. So we'll continue with the same in next after post lunch session. Any question is there till now? With the same thing we'll continue next also till here. If any issues there, you please ask me. Any question? Anything is there? So what we have discussed from the morning till now? We discussed about OSI. Then TCP/IP, inside TCP/IP application layer protocol we discuss. Then we discuss transport layer protocols. Then we discuss network layer protocol, and then finally we are discussing this data lake layer protocol, right? Any question? Ramesh, can I continue for next 10 minutes or what?
We'll take break, sir. We'll take 5 minutes break, and we can continue, sir. Sir, if you want to can continue, then I'll take, sir.
Naresh, are you there? Naresh? Because I have to stop by 10:45. If I can continue, you tell me, I'll continue. Okay, next part that speaker has come. So I'll just stop here. We'll continue from the same in the next post lunch session. Okay, thank you very much.
There are unmute camera.
Sir, we'll take a break of 5 minutes.
Good morning, all of you. This is Pravesh from CDAC Bangalore. Just would like to introduce myself. I'm a project engineer. I'm working as a project engineer at CDAC Bangalore. And I'll be taking some sessions on information gathering today. So hope I'm audible to all of you.
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah. So we'll start. Just give me 1 minute. Okay, so what basically is information gathering? It means what you have studied till now, that like a TCP/IP suit sir has told, since it has told everything about that, what the TCP/IP. So in terms of information gathering, we'll see in general term, we'll see what is information gathering, and in terms of cyber security or in with respect to the attacker, we'll see what information gathering will actually say about that, and we'll see some tools that are actually will help you to find out what are the things provided by the server, what are the configurations of the server, or in general terms, what are the applications running on the servers, like that. So what is general information gathering is, in general, the collecting the information of anything to achieve a target, right? So just a basic information gathering is, you want something to be achieved, and you are gathering some information, just in general terms. But in a ethical hacking terms, or if you say in a cyber security terms, we'll change a little something to in the mindset of an attacker, let's say. So in terms of hacking, we'll say the collecting the information of the victim and target, which helps our attacker to execute a cyber attack, right? Means if you want to perform some attack, you want to achieve some attack, or an attacker wants to do perform something, like just for example of denial of service also, if he wants to do. So something will be required, right? Blindly he can't go to the IP address and do everything, right? So he has to do some work on that particular server. He has to work, or he or she has to work on some aspects of the what are the things, what are the configurations required to perform a successful attack on that particular server, right? So this is basically a information gathering in terms of cyber security, or in terms of ethical hacking, or for a attacker or a hacker, we can say. So information gathering is collecting the information of the victim or target. It may be a server, it may be a normal IP address, it may be a you can say it may be a user also, and we can say for example, if you're performing attack on let's say some web application, right? If one web application is there, so what we can do is we'll collect all the information, since web application is running on which server, what kind of technologies it is using, means on top of that, what is the means what is the source code of that application, if you can find out what is the source code, means what is the technology we have used, in that manufacturer has used to deploy that particular service, right? So it is divided, basically it is divided into two parts, passive and active. So there will be one passive information gathering, and another will be the active information gathering, right? So for the passive information gathering, what it says is, directly move to the next slide, I'll tell you what is the passive information gathering. It also called as open source intelligence. Okay, that means a server or application is running somewhere, and you can gather the information without directly contacting to that particular service, right? Means we are not directly contacting to that server, we are not directly contacting to the application or the victim. We'll say as a target, we'll say in terms of ethical hacking, we'll move as a target. Okay, we'll use our target. So we don't know about the target, means we want to know about the target, but we can't directly connect to the target, we can't directly talk to the target, and we'll try to achieve the information, we'll try to gather the information, what are available on the web or what are available on the publicly available informations out there, those things we'll see, we'll find out and we'll collect those things. That will consider as a passive information gathering. Okay. Second will be the active information gathering. Means in this one, just opposite of passive, we can directly contact to the server. Means just in terms of, we'll say in terms of pinging also, just small example. Okay. We can directly ping to the server and we can check whether it's up or not. So it means we are directly contacting to the server and we are asking that, hey, you are on or you are off. Means you are running actually, what, how it is, right? So we are directly contacting, means it will be considered as a active information gathering, right? So it's a very basic term, passive and active. No need to, means I think there should be no confusion in the passive and active information gathering. So in this one, we'll see some tools which are available, some open source tools are there, some property tools are there. So I'll not say only tools, actually it we can consider it as a techniques also, right? So we'll look into one by one. I've collected some tools. There are plenty of tools available in the internet to collect the information about the applications or about the IP addresses or the users, we can say, right? So one by one, we'll move to the services and one by one, we'll see how it is going to, means how it will help us to complete the target, complete the attack or complete to gather the information of the particular website, a particular application or a particular IP addresses like that. Okay. So in all the tools, I'll be considering two websites. One will be the our CDAC.in itself. It's a publicly available website, and also one website for testing, that is megacorp1.com. Okay. So megacorp1.com is also just for testing website. It's not actually a designated organization. They have just made for testing purposes, and they are having already some vulnerabilities are there. And CDAC.in, we'll find out, means what if we can check what are the things available for the CDAC.in publicly, right? So I'm not going to use any of the internal network to connect to these websites, right? It will be completely on the web-based. And some tools we'll see, like this is the Harvester as a Kali-based tool. I'll tell you about the Kali just for 2 minutes. Kali Linux is a very good platform for the ethical hacking practices and penetration testings, because ethical hacking things and what are the tools are required to, from the information gathering to the scanning to the achieving a complete attack, the set of tools are available in the Kali Linux, right? It's a Linux-based platform. So we'll use some, I think, Whois will use from the Kali Linux, and the Harvester will use from the Kali Linux. Others will see manually. Okay, so website reconnaissance. First will be the website reconnaissance. So what you can understand from the website reconnaissance is, let's say, normal, means a general information, if you want, any general information, if you want to capture from the website, what we are doing, let's say example, I'll open my browser. Okay. I opened the browser, I'm typing, let's say www.cdac.in. This is the website, okay. Opening, I think, let's see, it's slow. Okay, so website reconnaissance, I'll tell you the difference, what are difference between a normal person and a person with a attacking mindset, or you can say an intruder, we should say intruder. Right, those who want to make harm, those who want to fulfill that their needs, just using the hacking techniques to the website, right? So what a general process will be there, we'll see the website, we'll see these things. These are the, okay, the applications are available, the servers are available here, and what are the services CDAC is providing is completely written over there, right? But usually we don't go to the bottom side of the where the contact details are written over there, right? So anyway, it's a publicly available, it's fine. We can see the source page also, right, of the website. So at least from seeing this source page, we can identify what are the technologies used, at least some of the technologies used to build this particular website. So why I want to see the technologies built on this website, so that I can find out the vulnerabilities present in these types of technologies. Let's say it's a HTML is there, So HTML injection will be possible on these types of websites, right? If they have used somewhere, let's say script tags. Script tags, just for example, I'm telling you, I don't want to go in much deeper in this one. If they're using a script tag, they must have used a JavaScript. So we can go for a cross-site scripting things, right? So the information I want from this website, we can consider to check the source page as well as the contact informations. Why contact informations? Because I'll get the email IDs of the maybe some of the employees like that, or any of the means users I can identify. I can guess at least what are the users present. You maybe the user will be present. Some contact details, right? Some contact details I can get it from that. What are the things related to these websites? If I'll go to another website, I'll show you some real examples. Maybe should come. Yes, MiraCorp one, right? This is a testing website. You can go with this website and check what are things available, right? So here also you can check a general reconnaissance. I'm telling, not go inside very deep inside what are the actually website is providing to you and all. So we can identify the things by checking the contact details, right? Like here you can see CEO email ID is there, some VP of legal email ID is there, right? So these are the email IDs present. So what I can identify from this is there must be some three users named as JOE, Joe, okay, Mackerel and Agrofield, right? So these are the three users present here. Means the terminologies may be like that, whatever the name of the person, it may be considered, means we can use it as an email ID also. They are using a terminology, they're using a method to develop an email ID to the initial of the name of the person. We can guess at least, we are not sure about this, but we can guess at least what other things can be identified from here, right? So these types of things we can, with whatever we are gathering from, this will be useful in the next terms of the attacking process, right? For the example, if I got some page to log in to this website, let's say here only, right? Or I got some SSH connections, right? Remote shell connections I got somewhere, that this server is holding a remote connection. So at least I can guess it, okay, this Joe must be the user. So at least one part of the thing is clear for me, a Joe can be a user, or any of the other contacts we can say that can be a user, right? So a general reconnaissance on the website is a web reconnaissance we tell, it's a very important thing. Just not only checking the website, what is providing, what it is providing, what are the services available from the organization. Apart from that, you should see, means as a information security auditor, if you can say, or as an attacker, you can say, you should see what are the things you are revealing to the internet, right? Which should not be exactly revealed to the main page of that websites and all, right? Without your permissions and all. So website reconnaissance is all about this. Checking general reconnaissance of the website, whichever you are going to, right? I think some problems there. Just website page is not here. Okay, sorry. I think I have not shared everything. Okay, sorry, I'll share my screen. Okay, I think now visible website, not visible. Sorry, I was not able to see the chat, I think. Okay, so this is the website, MegaCorp one, and this is the CDAC.in website, right? So these are, we are just identifying what are the things available publicly from the websites and how we can use the data, how we can use the information, what we are gathering from these websites, and we can use it further, right? You can say it in terms of attacking, or you can say in terms of defense also, right? So I was just telling, these users are available here, like email IDs are available here. So there's a general practice like that. What you are using for the email ID will be the username for login of the most of the applications present in the web server. Just for example, if it's a web server, it may contain SSH also, right? its possibility is there, right? So it may be having a user for the CEO so that a CEO can log into the server and check what are the things are happening. In practical scenarios, doesn't mean it's not required to log in directly from by the CEO or MVP of legal, but in general terms, I'm telling you just for learning purpose, okay? Right. So this contact page, if you're seeing here, the contact page says that, like McCarlo is there. So this person may be a user in the server, in the application server, right? So if you're getting a page to log in somewhere, so half of the part means the username part, you can at least say that, yes, I know the user at least. And the password part, you can work it on later on with the helping of that other tools and all, right? In same terms, like cdat.in is a website. So other than whatever is present in these websites, we can go for the source page. We can go for the source page. This is what I was telling you. Like if he's using script tags here, if they are using web application, in the application they are using script tags, but there may be a possibility of an attack called as cross-site scripting, right? It's a possibility. We're not going to test this one because anyway, some mechanisms are there for prevention of these types of attacks. I'm just telling the example, if you got some information from the source page, you can consider that it may be a possibility of these types of attacks, or it may be a possibility of some insensitive information if the source page is given to you. We can see, I think it's not there, nothing is there here. But in some vulnerable websites, if you see for testing websites is present, they will give you some vulnerable application, right? Okay, cross-site scripting attack, sir, is asking what is cross-site scripting attack. So cross-site scripting attack is something which using of the script tags, I'll tell you in a simpler way, using of this script tags, you can run your own scripts on the web server, okay, on a web application from the website, directly from the website, so that it will give you some important information. For example, I can steal the session cookies using the cross-site scripting attack to a web application, right? In general terms, you will find out the cross-site scripting attacks in these types of things, like in search bars or in the login panels, right? Username, password panels, or maybe in the search bars or where you are storing. So there are different types of cross-site scripting are there. So we'll not go further on that. And the basic understanding is like that. You can just check the information. You can gather some data, some important, some confidential data using the cross-site scripting, which will be achieved by this search options, or maybe the area where you can use when you can do some input, where you can put some inputs from the user end. Okay, so that is based on these script tags. Okay, means we can think of that if they're using a script tags, it may be a possibility, right? Okay. So this was the website reconnaissance, all about the website reconnaissance. Now, we'll move to a Whois tool. There's one very good tool called Whois. I'll show you. So my VM is visible. Can anybody please reply if my VM is visible, virtual machine is visible. Yeah, thank you. So this is the Kali Linux 2020. They have a build set for 2021 also. So hope many of you are knowing about the screen that it's appearing. It's a Kali Linux, which will help you in, you can say, for all the aspects of ethical hacking, from information gathering, scanning techniques, attacking techniques. So hope the screen is fine, I think. I think screen is fine right now. Okay. Okay, so Whois is a command. I'll just check if you can identify. Yes, so one man command is there to check on the what are the functionalities, what are the options, and all about the command available in the Kali Linux or any of the Linux. You can just check, you can use this command man and put whichever command you want to check. Like if I want to check this command, means what this command is providing to me. So it is giving all the options and descriptions, everything you can check in the Linux. Okay, it's a very important command to study, to learn about the new commands, right? So you can use for the further exploring the whois command. I'll go with some small example of whois. Okay, so if I say whois 8.8.8, this is a public DNS of Google. Okay, it's a DNS server provided by the Google. The IP address, the 8.8.8.8. So I'll say who is 8.8.8.8. Okay. So it is giving me some information, and we'll see what all information it is giving. Net range it is giving. This will be the net range for this IP belongs to. CIDR notation it is giving me. Origin, we'll see what are the important things you can see. Organization level 3 parent, okay. So any good information? I think because Google are much smarter that they will not reveal all the information. Yes, something we are getting. The email address, we got email IP addressing at the rate level3.com. There is something, some domain they're using named as level3.com, in which there will be a user or maybe a group called as IP addressing, right? This belongs to when you are searching for the information of the Google, right? So we'll not go much in the Google. We'll see some small examples of cdac.in. Okay. So if I'm searching for cdac.in, it is giving me these types of information, right? These types of information says that registered organization is a center for development of advanced computing, it is saying here. Okay. And postal code and all, it is saying redacted for privacy. These types of things you can configure. So why I'm showing you that if you're hosting a very confidential website, or if you're hosting some confidential data on your website, so that should be protected. That should be in a privacy, that if you are using some such tools like whois and all, should not reveal all the information, right? This much information is fine when it was updated, what is the organization name, and what are the things present, what are the like numbers and all, it is not written here. Okay, country it is written, but some of the websites, what they tell is, they will reveal the numbers also, they will reveal the email IDs also. Many things they will reveal. Okay, sorry. So these are the informations available. So this who is also, they are maintaining their own database. Someone is asking that who is reads information from where. So they are also maintaining their database, and the public information available from there only they will maintain these databases. From there they are giving the information, right? And some set of protocols, some set of tools they are using internally, which will reveal the direct information from these servers, right? So means this time I'm not directly contacting the server, but maybe from the available information, so we can take these types of critical things from the servers. If we'll go with the name server, you can see here remote1.easydns.com. So here some DNS servers which cdac.in is using, right? What are the DNS servers publicly available it is using? It is revealing those servers also, the names of those servers. NS1.cdac.in, these are the name servers, means for resolving the IP addresses and all. Right, this name servers it is using. We'll see one more website. I think it will be much clearer in this one. Why I'm using this one, I'll show you. Yes, for the same, it is showing here the name servers present in this one also, right? You can see. And see, registrar abuse contact phone number also, it is saying. It is saying the email ID also, it is saying the contact number also. So these types of information is not required to reveal, right? Means what is the use of this information? Okay, so these types of information and the name server can be checked from the host server. Now you can see here, the registrar name it is showing, Allen Grofield, organization name is Megacorp One. Even it is showing the address also, the email addresses, right? This is something different stuff in the email, right? So these types of things you can check. So why I've shown you this website, because it is revealing too much things, which was not required, right? So this is the host command, basic use of host. You can simply put host and a website name in front of that. That will reveal many of the things if it is available on the website and if it's available on the database of these. Okay. So we'll move to the next one. That is Google Docs, the techniques which are used for Google hacking, not Google hacking. Google hacking, we have heard that. But that is not actually the Google hacking. It's not like that you are going to hack Google and all. You are just going to use the Google in a more efficient way so that you can gather more and more information from the Google about the publicly available informations, right? So we'll see Google Docs. Okay. Hope my Chrome is visible to all of you. Okay, we are on Google. Fine. So if I want to search any of the websites, I'll take this one website. If you want to suggest me, you can suggest me in the chat of any other website you want to see. Megacorp1.com. Okay. What we are doing is whenever you want to search something, we'll directly type in the Google search and we will find out the result and we get confused which link has to be open. And where we can get the exact information from these links available, right? Whatever the Google is suggesting, whatever Google is advising us to check these links, we sometimes get confused, right? So using in more efficient way, we can use it as I want only the site as megacorp1.com. This means that only tell me the results where the website name is only megacorp1.com. Okay. If I say enter, so most of the first results will be belongs to megacorp1.com only, not from any other. We'll see if possible in the third pages. Till third pages, yes. Till third pages, the last pages also, it will give me only the results of the pages available from the megacorp1.com publicly. This one is the basic one. The site we can use. This one for searching the website, right? Whatever the results we are getting should be precise to this particular website only. If I say site colon cdac.in, it will give me the website names which contains cdac.in. You can see every website, every result must have cdac.in. It will be there. You can move it to any of the pages. It will give me all the results where website contains cdac.in. The website name contains cdac.in, right? Like this, we have many Google Docs. I'll just tell you one by one some four or five techniques to search for the Google in a more efficient way, more in a precise way to gather the important informations for the applications, for the servers and all. Okay. Mostly for the websites, we'll use only for the websites here. So I'm telling you these two websites because of that, the scope should be limited, and this one will not go for the most publicly websites because we don't want to tell Google that we are planning any attack or we are doing something malicious, because Google will think like that. If you're searching, you keep searching everything, multiple websites, Google will think like that. They want to do something malicious. So it will immediately give a capture, immediately give a, that I'm not a robot kind of thing and all stuff. So okay, so I'll use these two abstracts only, cj.in and megacorp1.com. So the second is file type. I'll show you what is the file type. File type. Okay. File type, same column we'll use. And if we'll say file type, okay. We'll say site. I want some information about I'll say networking. Okay. I'll give a file type as PDF. Okay, you can see the extension here, right? I'll search. So what are the possibilities it is giving? What are the possibilities Google is giving is only the PDFs. You can see here. You can see what are the links it is providing me. All are PDFs. Right, this is the PDF, this will be the PDF loading, this is also a PDF. So what it is searching is networking, but the file type will be PDF. I'll say a file type can be a PHP, so it will give me the PHP pages which contains this word named as networking, right? If I want to combine these searches, I'll say site cj.in file type PHP. Okay, there is no file with PHP. Say PDF. Yes, PDF is available. So there are some PDFs available in the site which has been cj.in in their domain name. Right. So I think there is no confusion till here in the site and the file type. File say. You give me all the files, but I don't want the files related to HTML, because HTML I can directly search on the Google. Whenever I'm searching about this website, it is always giving me the HTML and PHP pages. So I want to ignore these pages, and whatever is present apart from the HTML file type, please show me. That will be, we can achieve using site as cj.in and minus file type HTML. Okay. So whatever is present here, it's not, it doesn't belongs to the HTML pages. If I say PHP, it will exclude all the PHP pages, okay, and show me the other pages available in other whatever the other extensions are available in that. Okay, so it will go on. You can just look into other pages also. It will not contain any of the PHP pages here, right? So next is in title. Okay, in title. So as the name itself is saying, in title means whatever is present in title. I'll say some Mars mission. So what should it should give as a result? Can anybody please just put in the chat what should be the result if I'm saying in title Mars mission? I'm saying in title Mars mission in double quotes. What can be the result? Okay, NASA. Okay. The thing is, in title means the title of the web page, whichever page will be opened by the Google, whichever the pages, whichever the websites will be searched by the Google, in the title of that page, the Mars mission, the word the Mars and mission. Okay, these two words will be mentioned there. Yes, all websites that would have dealt with would be Mars mission, right? So if I say enter here, in any of the titles, you can see there will be somewhere written as Mars space mission. Any of the websites you can see, or what are the pages it is revealing, what are the pages it is showing, there will be one word named as Mars mission. You can see any of the title you can see, there will be one word called as Mars mission. So I'm giving you an example of this Mars mission. You can use it in a more efficient way. You can use, I'll say WannaCry. This was a ransomware attack, WannaCry. I'll say in title WannaCry. So everything available from the Google, from the websites, different websites containing the WannaCry as a title will show on this page. Okay, this is a very important one. If you want to, why we are doing is, if you directly search WannaCry, I know it will reveal many of the things, but it doesn't mean that it will give you the most precise information or most of the information, right? So I say this has to be in the title, or you can use the combination like site, or we'll say from here only Kaspersky.co.in. Okay. Kaspersky.co.in in title will say WannaCry, and I don't want any of the HTML pages, or will say I want some PDFs to read. It is available, it will show you. If it's not, it may not be. Okay, we'll see. Okay, no PDF is available. No problem. I'll say in title virus. Okay, it's not there in the Kaspersky.it. So no PDFs are available, but okay. We'll see some HTML pages. It is available. I'll remove this file type because more this one. Okay, now. So like that, you can see only in the Kaspersky.co.in, I want the details about WannaCry. So like this, we can combine these searches, and we can use it in a more efficient way, either with the mentality of an attacker or a security personnel. Okay, means what are the things my website or our own personal website is revealing to the internet. Using these things, we can search, right? So next one is in text. So if in title is saying that whichever is present in the title, show me, what will be the in text? In text will be in the content one, right? I want something from the content. In text, if I'll do, okay, now Google has got it. That we are keep searching, we are using this Google Docs. So it is giving us a warning kind of, I hope you are not a robot. Okay. So in text is as simple as that. In the content, means in the content of the website, in the content of the pages, what are the things present? It should contain a word called CDAC. It will give you those pages. Okay. And one more important point is that in URL. Okay. So there's one very good example I'll give you. Config underscore, let's say network IP dot HTML. Okay. We'll see. Yes, so the network configurations, I think by mistake they have kept on this public IP address. It's not opening here. I think there's some restrictions from our end. I think there's some restrictions from this side to open, but yes, kind of configuration files, kind of things which is already present in the URL. This URL, whichever the URL is there in the URL, if these types of tags are present, like set underscore config network IP dot HTML is present, it will show you. You can change it, you can manipulate it, and you can see what all informations you can find out. Means in URL is what are the contents present in the URL, right? So this will also give you more precise information if you're using in title, in URL, right? So kind of these many are available, these types of tags are available in the internet. You can search for Google Docs, or better, Google Hacking database. Okay. You will get a very good website called as ExploitDB. Okay. This is a website called as ExploitDB. You can search this website. We'll see what is opening. It's taking too much time. basically this website is open now. Yes, here you can see plenty of the Google Docs and a way of means you can see in different types of searches you can find out, like say in total HDIP cameras, right? You see a better box, you can see, find out something, simply copy it. Let's see if it can give some results. Save HDIP camera, okay. So most possibly these are the public IP address on which some IP cameras are running. So anyway, it will ask you the logins here, because although it's on a public IP address, but it may have a login ID and password, right? So that we can't log into them. So this was just an example using the Google Docs. Yes. It is giving. So this is a public IP address. Somewhere on this public IP address, one DBR may be running, which will allow you to log in with a username and password. Okay. We'll not try here because it may generate logs on their end, but attacker can do that, right? Manipulating, spoofing the things, generating a false network. They can do that. They'll put some username and password. Okay, this was the only thing I was telling you. Like attention HDIP cameras. I'll check the source page if I can get something. Customer custom product is there. Okay. Like this, if I can get some details about this attention HDIP camera, I can find out how we can see the usernames, how we can guess the passwords. If I get the information of this IP address, where it is running actually, and who is the owner of this one. So at least we can find out something, right? What can be the username? It may be admin user, it may be a name of a person, right? So these types of things you can generate, you can combine all those things to gather the information and to achieve a successful attack or to defend also, so that whatever the information your website and your application is revealing to the public, right? Because while configuring, while developing, we don't know exactly. We can control these things, but the testing is required. The actual testing is required for these types of things, so that we can prevent our data, prevent our confidential properties. We can prevent those things so that should not be revealed on the internet, right? So you can use this Google database. This website ExploitDB contains many of the tags available on this website. Okay. Now the next one will move with the Netcraft. Netcraft is another website which will give you informations related to web application servers and IP addresses also. So there's a website called netcraft.com. Parallelly, if you want, you can also try. It's just a normal website. Netcraft.com, okay. They have updated their website. You go to the resources, you can search DNS. Okay. I'll say host as cdot.in. You can use your multiple filters here. So that site starts with this URL, or site ends with this URL, or subdomains, whatever that. Okay. So I'm saying site contains cdag.in. Whatever the websites present on the internet should contain cdag.in in their website domain, like the domain name. I say search. So these are all websites. Yes, approximately 20 results it is giving, which contains the cdag.in. If you want me to zoom, I can zoom. You can see webmail.cdag.in, pramani.cdag.in, ihrms, www.cdag.in, afcat.cdag.in, general.cdag.in. So they are all the application web servers, web applications running on these website, these domain names, right? You can see. You can search for your organization also, that what all websites it is running. And accordingly, it will give you, it will reveal the OS information available in the right side. You can see it is in the Linux CentOS, this pramani.cdag.in, right? It is in the Windows Server 2008, this one, www.cdag.in. And these are not able to see what are the servers, okay? So how to check the application servers, which on which server these applications are running, will show you in the active scanning, okay? This is the passive scanning why means I'm not directly contacting to the CDAC. It is available from the Netcraft for public, right? I'll see, I'll say one, okay, CDAC.in will see the report here. You can see the site report, that this site, there's one document is there. You can click on site report for the, this particular URL called CDAC.in. So it is giving me, okay, it is opening, it's taking a little time, yeah. Refresh properly, okay. Yes, so what are our things it is revealing is, you can see kind of who is was a terminal based, and you can say you can use the lookups in the web based also. Netcraft is a very good website which will give you most of the things here. So these are the IP addresses range this has given. This is the IP address which on top of that CDAC.in is running, and who has provided the IP addresses in these countries. Okay, these are the RIRs who are providing the IP addresses in this country, SSL and TLS. Okay, so these are the servers and versions, web servers, which are updated. And this is the holding, okay. So these kinds of things you can see for your website also, you can check. For your organizations also, you can check. I'll see megacorp1.com, if it is revealing something. megacorp1.com. Okay, I'll see the same website. It says in the Linux and Debian, and I'll check the report. What is the report of this website? So domain it is saying here, and name server organization. Okay, domain registrar, top level domains. This is hosted in the country, United States. Hosting history. These were the all servers, and these were the all IP addresses on which this domain was. Search IK. Okay, so I can see, check sysmo.gov.in. So it is asking for sysmo.gov.in. Yes, I'll try this one also. Okay, web trackers are there. Site technology that is showing me the web servers, what it is using. So it says as Apache on Debian. Netlogy means Apache is a web server. They're using Apache web server, okay? And operating system is Debian. They have used the JavaScript. Yes, most of the things it is revealing, most of the things it is saying that this is technologies they have used. For the HTTP compression also, they have used the encoding, gzip content encoding, okay? Document type, CSS usage, they are telling. Right, so these are sort of stuff you can find out from the websites. I'll see for the new search. sysmo.gov.in. So it's having only one domain named as sysmo.gov.in. I think there's no other domains till now. So it says for Indian Meteorological Department, New Delhi. Okay, you see the report. Yes, so something that is trying, it is processing still. We'll see, okay, not present, it is in description and all. Okay, so it's not revealing much things, but yeah, IP address is fine, IP address you can. National Language Network, yes, so this organization is using the NKN as a ISP. The first level ISP is National Knowledge Network, it is saying that. This is the IP range provided to this organization. And they are also having one server running for the Australia. And others in India with RS Money NKN and NKN IMD Delhi. Okay, just provided one. Okay, there's not much information, but it's not revealing much information. So I think, yes, it's a very good thing that we are not able to see much information publicly available in the Netcraft, right? So hope you understood about the Netcraft. You can simply give the IP address, or you can directly give the domain name, and we'll give the information publicly available for the Netcraft database. From wherever they have taken it, they have stored it, and whenever it is required, they'll show you according to your requirement of the domain name, right? Okay. So the next one is almost similar to this one, that is Shodan, shodan.io. I think many of you have heard about this Shodan.io. Shodan.io. This also you can please check on your web servers, check on your browsers, please. Parallel, you can try if you want, you can try it. Shodan.io. So here you have to create one account, and anyway, we'll not create now any account. We'll just move directly with the searching. And if you want to purchase some additional information, means if you want to see some additional information, you can purchase this with their logins. They're having some purchase option, which will give you most, means which will give you more information in terms of the free version, in respect to free version. So, okay. So, Shodan.io, I'll see. Okay, we'll see the same website what Sarah suggested here. Sysmo.gov. We'll see if Shodan can give anything extra other than the Netcraft. And basically, the Shodan will tell you the public IP addresses also. Okay, it's not giving no result found, it says. Okay, no problem. We'll see CDAC. CDAC.in. Yes, somewhere it is telling you. So this is the SSL certificates, this is the user agents. Right? So if you can write website also, you can write, if you want to write operating system, I think operating system also it will take. Linux, if you say, it will give you all the results with the Linux servers. Wherever see, you can see the Linux, it is written. Whatever the servers present in the world, and which is in the database of Shodan running on Linux, it's showing here in the search. You can see total results are here 51,22,221, right? So of course we can't see each and everything here, each and every server. So we'll get more specific to the CDAC.in, and we'll see, we'll try to find out. So we'll give you the IP address open privacy here. So it will not open problem. Yeah. So this is revealing some things. What kind of data it is saying here, that SSL certificates, it is showing SSL certificates here, IP address it is saying, location it is saying India, Patna, okay. And IP addresses of the websites the server is holding. Okay, we'll try to find a Raspbian. Yeah, okay, sorry. Raspbian is the operating system used in Raspberry Pi and so on, the most of the IoT devices. Let's see if we can find out some Raspbian operating systems. Yes, these all are running on Raspbian. See if it works. This website is works. Okay. Just giving some data information. Like it will give you the public key here for the OpenSSH. So it says that services running on this application is SSH on top of TCP with the port number 222. Sorry, 4x2. So no need to go for that to scanning also, only directly it is telling that on the 2222, it is running OpenSSH server, which has the key. RSA key is here. And the algorithms they might have used, the suggested algorithms are there. Yes. So, yeah. So these types of things you can use, and you can find out what are the applications and what are the websites publicly available. So Raspbian, we have seen whichever devices using Raspbian and available on the public IP address are here, right? I'll see camera, what is there? It's from Amazon, we'll not search for Amazon. So it is some IP address, port number, it is saying it's available on the public IP address. Yes, it is asking for the login. Of course, it will ask for the login. That is the best practice. If it should not be available on the public IP address, no cameras should be available on the public IP address, but it is available also. At least it should have a strong authentication method. Right? Okay. So these are the types I've shown you, means these are the things how you can search in more efficient way using Shodan and Netcraft. So there are some 3-4 more techniques. We'll take a short break and we'll come back. Some 3-4 techniques are there. It will not take much time and we'll see that scanning part. So passive scanning, I'm having some 2-3 tools, not tools actually, web-based applications. After that, we'll see the passive scanning things. Okay. Sorry, active scanning things, where what we'll do, where we'll directly be in the touch, we'll directly be in the contact with the application server or IP address, means or the device which is holding that public IP address. We'll directly contact and try to reveal the information. We'll try to get some information which server can directly throw to us, not from the any other means publicly available website or any publicly available database. Will directly say application that, sir, I want this one, madam, I want this one, means like a normal IP address, please tell me what is this. Then they will it will reveal you from using the help of some tool that what are the services running on that server and what are the technologies used by that particular server or particular IP address. Okay, so we'll come back by 12. We'll take a 10 minutes break. Thank you.